Pray silence for the governor. There you go. Yeah, good. Welcome. I'm absolutely delighted to open this One Bank Research Conference. This is launching our One Bank Research Agenda, as you know. This is an ambitious, it's a wide-ranging framework that's looking to transform, and we really mean that, transform the way research is done at the bank, but part of that transformation is at the bank and beyond, very much as I'll try to draw out. We're looking to improve the coordination of our research across all of the policy areas of the bank, to make the best use of our data, and to cultivate an extensive research community that spans the bank and very much outside these walls. As I hope all of you know, the bank has a single timeless mission, which is to promote the good of the people of the United Kingdom. We do that by maintaining monetary and financial stability. Now, to borrow from Keynes, I would say that to deliver that mission, we must study the present in light of the past for the purposes of the future. But we have to do more than that. We can't be Keynes's proverbial madmen in authority as policymakers, mad persons in authority, it should be, distilling their frenzy from some academic scribbler of a few years back. What we need is contemporaneous and open collaboration between researchers and policymakers, and that's what we're trying to do, and I'll draw that out. In order to accomplish this, we need to change both our research focus, develop a much deeper understanding of the interrelationships between microprudential, macroprudential, and monetary policies, as well as change the way we perform research here at the bank, and that includes the development of a more open and permeable and policy-driven approach. And so the One Bank research agenda is obviously central to both of those transformations. In short, what we're looking to do is to transform research at the bank to the same extent as the responsibilities of the bank have been transformed or were transformed in the wake of the financial crisis. The central challenge of macroeconomic policymaking in the UK, certainly, but UK and beyond in the 70s and 80s, was the fight against inflation. And in no small part due to our predecessors, particularly Lord King, we have today a regime for maintaining monetary stability that is both democratically legitimate and highly effective. It rests on clear remits, delegated by Parliament, sound government governance arrangements to support independence, and the effective transparency of policymaking. And it provides valuable lessons for the conduct of other policy functions. But despite these successes, in both theory and practice, a healthy focus on price stability had become, over time, a dangerous distraction. The financial crisis was a powerful reminder that price stability isn't sufficient for macroeconomic stability, and it exposed the convenient fiction that finance is a veil. And we were taught that the dynamics of lending markets are almost as important as those of labor markets. In response to those painful lessons, the Bank of England has been bestowed with enormous new responsibilities by Parliament, spanning monetary policy, macroprudential policy, microprudential supervision. They're added to existing responsibilities, which include those for the issuance of the currency, oversight of the payment system, oversight of financial market infrastructure, and now additional responsibility for resolving failed institutions. To fulfill our missions on top of that, we have core roles in Europe at the G20 at the Financial Stability Board. Now, having all those responsibilities under one roof makes enormous gains from trade possible. And it's our duty to exploit those complementarities, those synergies, those economies of scope in order to maximize the impact by working together. And to do so, we need research. And I would suggest that to some extent, research needs us. Now, let me speak a bit about the need for research in a bit more detail. The way that central banks have sought to achieve their objectives, the actual practice of central banking, has frequently moved ahead of the theory of central banking. What happens is theory subsequently catches up, passes us, enriches and refines those practices. And history of central banking is replete with examples. where tacit knowledge has often been more instrumental in determining policy outcomes than insights from formal research. Sometimes this works, as in Badgett's dictum, and sometimes it doesn't, as in Montague Norman's never explain, never excuse. Research has meant that some modes of operation, such as Norman's, have rightly fallen by the wayside. And research has certainly meant that it's certainly helped to nuance other approaches like Badgett's. And it's guided us as to which practices to refine, which to reinforce, which to enhance, and what should be discarded. So the practice of monetary policy during the Great Moderation is another example of this. The actual practice informed theorizing and research on inflation targeting. And in turn, through trial and error and refinement, research helped inform policy with both empirical insights and highly effective workhorse models. Now, in the theoretical space, this process led to conclusions such as, and I'm paraphrasing, Woodford's dictum, that in modern central banking, very little else matters beyond expectations. Now, in contrast, the practice of central banking in a messy real world where people use various heuristics, including rational inattention and other methods, has shown the limitations of such logical extremes. So practice moves ahead of theory, theory catches up, refines practice, and the effectiveness of policy can improve as a result. There's other areas during the crisis. Certainly, practice had to once again leap ahead of theory. During its depths, the lessons of history and insights from psychology were arguably more important and more valuable than the precisions of dynamic programming. In fact, our workhorse models didn't even have financial sectors, so meaning questions of financial stability weren't even asked, let alone answered. And there was a great deal of improvisation required to avoid a second Great Depression. Now, that's a rich set of experiences. I think we got more right than we got wrong, but it's for others to make those judgments. I see Charles smiling broadly there. I'm going to leave during your session, Charles, so I don't have to. And it's vital that we draw on those experiences from the crisis to rethink the way we understand the economy, the financial system, and the very institutions that we now supervise. In order to do so, we need not only to study recent history more deeply, but also to apply formal methods to refine our depictions of economic dynamics as well as the policy tools we have to shape those dynamics in socially desirable ways. And we need to catalyze thinking on new approaches towards policies that have assumed much greater importance since the crisis, including macroprudential policy and bank resolution. So at the Bank of England, our enhanced research function, including our new research hub, will bring together staff and thinking from across the institution to create a two-way flow between research and policy under Andy's leadership. It will also seek to foster a shared understanding of the frontier of policy possibilities amongst colleagues and ensure that the insights gained from one policy area, for example, monetary policy in terms of effective transparency, can benefit others. But these efforts won't succeed if they're confined only to the corridors of Threadneedle and Moorgate. The bank recognizes that we need to do much more to reach out to the wider research community. Policy making can benefit tremendously from insights in all aspects of economics and finance, from psychology to epidemiology, from computer science to law. And that's why I'm pleased to see that we have such a wide range of discussants and participants at today's conference. Now, in order to focus the conversations, we need to be clear about the key questions which interest us as policymakers the most. And I want to now turn to those. Our One Bank research agenda is structured around five themes, which span all aspects of central banking. These themes are necessarily broad, but they all focus on the interactions and intersections between our policy areas. They reflect the diversity of our agenda. They emphasize new challenges and new directions, while recognizing that some of the perennial questions that face central banks remain relevant. And obviously today's conference is organized around those five themes. So let me cover them briefly and then make a small announcement and then pass on to the real work. The first theme covers policy frameworks and interactions. The reemergence of macroprudential instruments as part of the policy armory raises fundamental questions about the interactions between monetary policy, macroprudential policy, and microprudential supervision. It's essential that we improve our understanding of the relationship between credit cycles and systemic risks. And since credit market developments both affect and reflect the potential growth in the broader economy, those developments, those credit market developments, and the macroprudential measures we use to influence them require careful study by financial and monetary policy makers alike. The advent of a new enhanced policy toolkit also raises vital questions about the effectiveness of the individual policy tools, crucially their joint operation, and how they interact both domestically and across borders. The second theme covers regulation, resolution, and market structures. Now, as I've mentioned and you know, the crisis precipitated a radical overhaul of the approach to these issues. Regulatory policies have shifted from a near exclusive focus on microprudential resilience, making the institutions strong, to a more balanced emphasis on minimizing systemic risk, making the system more resilient. Now, in a whirlwind of essential change, there has been, however, relatively little assessment of the overall effects of reform on the financial system as a whole. Moreover, our understanding of the system must extend much beyond the banking system to include all aspects of market-based finance. The third theme covers policy operationalization. Wow. Okay, that's the last time I'm going to say that. And implementation, doing policy, that's what it's about. We have to change, rebrand it. The practice of central banking constantly underscores that implementation and the communication of policy can be as important as its design. Now, during the crisis, central banks made imaginative and extensive use of their balance sheets in pursuit of their objectives. Now, that experience gives us an unparalleled experience base or unparalleled opportunity to take stock of what worked and why. You know, in Ben Bernanke's famous observation, the trouble with QE is that it works in practice, but it doesn't work in theory. So understanding better, we have some theories about this, and certainly more than an elementary understanding of how it works. But we need to understand better the transmission mechanisms of QE and the extent to which they are state dependent. And all of this can provide enormous insights, not just to the effectiveness of that policy tool specifically, but also the formation of agents' expectations and the very functioning of the financial system more generally. Now, recent innovations haven't been confined just to new tools. As I noted previously, better communication and greater transparency have also helped to make policy more effective. And this research theme continues in that vein by asking what more could be done to enhance effective transparency in all aspects of policy. The fourth research theme covers new data, methodologies, and approaches. Increasing amounts of data, structured and unstructured, current and historical, are available on almost every aspect of the economy and the financial system. And obviously, this holds great promise. Computing power has transformed our economies. Now it's important to harness it to transform our understanding of how those economies function. And theoretical and methodological techniques continue to advance. In some cases, that will mean measurement will come ahead of theory. And that certainly is one way to advance. It's better to have, in the short term, a black box than have nothing. And in fact, the patterns that one can divine from a black box can help prompt a greater understanding of the underlying forces. To bore an example, Kepler needed to uncover the empirics of planetary motion before Newton could conjure the theory of celestial mechanics. Now, it's important to exploit developments in advanced analytics of large data sets in order to formulate better policy. They'll improve our understanding of household and corporate behavior, the macroeconomy, and the risks of the financial system. They need to be harnessed to enhance our forecasting and stress testing capabilities as well. In order to complement this theme, we're going to release historical data sets, including detailed breakdowns of the bank's inflation expectation surveys, our agents' companies' visit scores, and very long back runs of key economic and financial variables. And this is one way we're looking to increase the permeability of our research. We're also seeking to explore new ways to visualize these increasingly rich information sets that we're making available. The fifth and final research theme covers the response to fundamental changes. And those include technological and structural trends, which will have a significant bearing on economic dynamics. In most cases, these trends will play out over a longer horizon than the traditional policy horizons of a central bank, the 2 to 3 year horizon in monetary policy, the up to decade long horizon of a credit cycle of macroprudential policy. But issues such as changing demography, increases in longevity, changes in inequality, climate change, the increased importance of emerging economies, and the development of digital currencies, this whole range of phenomena affect the evolution of real interest rates to risks in the financial sector, to the future of monetary, of money and banking itself. See, in the very long term, we're all dead and John Cunliffe arrives. And all of these trends have the potential to reshape our policy challenges, and we need research. We very much need research to put us on the front foot to face them. So before concluding, I just want to make one announcement around an effort to catalyze interest in this one bank research agenda. We certainly have interest in demonstrated today, but we're going to have two competitions on research. The first relates to what I just spoke about, data visualization. In order to coincide with the release of these new data sets, we want to see what novel insights they can yield. And so there's a range of options. It's up to researchers to decide which route to go. It could be just a static description of an interesting pattern or relationship, or the creation of an interactive approach, interactive app. Entrants are free, obviously, to focus on whatever they like, as long as it uses some of the new data in some way, and obviously it can be blended with any other data sets. The second competition is for the best research paper, consistent with the one bank. This is our sort of one bank research competition. And in this regard, we're particularly keen to engage in early career researchers across the academic world. For our inaugural competition, the paper should be on some aspect of the interaction between macroprudential, microprudential, and monetary policy. And the winners of each competition will be decided by separate judging panels that include bank staff and external academics. And the prize for both of the competitions will be £5,000 each. There's more details on our website on how to apply. So let me conclude and so that we can get started. We all know that economies are complex, dynamic, and constantly evolving systems. They're underpinned by social interactions shaped by behavioral change. They're shaped by fundamental forces like technology and globalization. And they're supported and at times disrupted by the financial system. Policymakers need research to help understand these phenomena and craft our responses to them. And research can make some of its most effective contributions by addressing the priorities of policymakers. By focusing on a clear set of research priorities, by opening up our data sets, by creating tighter links between policymakers and researchers, both within the bank and across the broader research community, we can all help advance the bank's mission of promoting the good of the people of the United Kingdom. And in order to do that, I will now get out of the way, hand over to John Cunliffe, I believe, to chair the first panel. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. I'm told my job here is decorative, but also disciplinarian. So it is simply to ensure that everything runs on time. Just say at the beginning, we have three excellent panellists for this first session, and the first session is kind of central to what we're looking for from the One Bank research agenda, which is really central bank policy frameworks and the interactions between monetary policy, macroprudential, and microprudential policy, both domestically and internationally, which goes to the heart of One Bank and bringing together the responsibilities that we have. And we have on the panel Misa Tanaka, who I think joined the bank in 2002 and has worked across a number of areas in the bank, including international MA, and is now responsible for managing research across the Prudential Policy Directorate. Hyun, Shin, who is now, was well known to us all, but now economic advisor and head of research at the BIS and took up that position in May 2014, but very deep experience in this area, including actually running sort of financial crises and macroprudential policy.
Hopefully not causing them.
Oh, causing them, okay. Well, we could talk about the causality. Maybe that's one of the things we can research will tell us which way the causality runs. Yes. And then Ricardo, Reis from Columbia University, focused on macroeconomics, but I think also started off many years ago, did a spell in the Bank of England, so welcome back. And you've straddled kind of policy making and academia and an advisor at the Fed Reserve Bank in Minneapolis and New York, so welcome. I'm going to stop there and just hand over to Misa to start us off. Thanks.
Thank you, John. I would like to give a short introduction to theme one of our research agenda, which is about central bank policy frameworks and interactions between monetary policy, macroprudential policy, and microprudential policy. Working? Sorry. There you go. So I think this research theme really emerges quite naturally from the intellectual challenges posed by the recent financial crisis. I think there were four main takeaways from it. All right. How come it doesn't work? All right, there you go. So first, price stability proved to be insufficient for ensuring macroeconomic stability, as Mark had already mentioned. Second, conventional monetary policy was inadequate for mopping up the impact of the crisis on output. Third, international capital flows did not necessarily represent efficient allocation of global savings into investments. And finally, the prevailing regulatory framework failed in spotting and acting on system-wide risks. The response to these challenges was to create a new policy which is explicitly aimed at mitigating systemic risk. And that's the new macroprudential policy. Today, monetary policy, macroprudential policy, and microprudential policy is operated by three separate committees within the Bank of England, and each has its own specific primary aims. Monetary policy is aimed at price stability, macroprudential policy is aimed at mitigating systemic risk, and microprudential policy seeks to maintain safety and soundness of individual institutions. But each of these can clearly influence both monetary and financial conditions, and so can affect the achievement of both monetary and financial stability objectives. So for us, a key area for research is how these policies interact and how the stance of each policy influences the effectiveness of the other two policies in achieving their aims. We also need to better understand when and how these policies need to be coordinated. For example, should monetary policy take account of its impact on risk-taking? And if so, how should that be coordinated with macroprudential policy? We also need more research to inform the development of a framework for the new macroprudential policy. In theory, macroprudential policy could be operated by a range of instruments, including balance sheet instruments such as countercyclical capital buffer and sectoral capital requirements, but also instruments that affect the terms and conditions of transactions, such as loan-to-value ratio limit. So a clear policy framework should help underpin accountability and anchor expectations by providing an objective and transparent guide on the choice of instruments, as well as the policy stance. A key challenge to this, though, is that we currently do not have a reliable measure of systemic risk which can be used as a target, analogous to an inflation target for monetary policy. There's also considerable uncertainty over how each of the macroprudential instruments influences systemic risk, given that we have limited experience of operating these instruments. And the drivers of systemic risk are also bound to change over time, not least in response to policy, but also in response to technological developments. So I think there are a number of outstanding questions here. Most importantly, when should a particular instrument be deployed, and how do different instruments interact with each other? And how do we assess the costs and benefits of acting versus not acting? To what extent can we rely on indicators to provide guidance on the appropriate policy stance, given that the relationship between the indicators and systemic risk could well be unstable? What role should stress tests play, and how can we improve them? For example, we do not currently have a clear methodology at the moment on how to construct the appropriate stress scenario. And even on conditional on a particular stress scenario, there's considerable uncertainty over the modeled impact of a scenario on the banking system. There are also questions over the future of monetary policy. The crisis has reignited the debate about whether the flexible inflation targeting remains the gold standard for monetary policy. Should alternative targets such as nominal GDP be considered? How should monetary policy framework respond to the possibility of hitting the zero lower bound? And what role should unconventional monetary policy instruments such as QE and four guidance play as the economy returns to more normal conditions? Finally, I think an important outstanding question is whether this trinity of policies can effectively deal with foreign shocks and policy spillovers. The stunning thing about the recent financial crisis was that a shock to a relatively small US subprime market ended up causing a chain of events that brought the global financial system to a brink of collapse. Yet, in the current setup, microprudential policy and macroprudential policy cannot do very much to influence international capital flows. So in a globalized world, do we need to expand the existing set of policy instruments? Alternatively, do we need to do more international policy coordination? So to sum up, these are some of the key questions that the bank is grappling with at the moment. And they revolve around policy interactions, monetary and macroprudential policy frameworks, and international spillovers. With that, I want to hand over to Hyun and Ricardo. Thank you very much.
Well, I'd like to thank the Bank of England for, first of all, inviting me and for organizing this event. I still have very fond memories of my time here collaborating with the excellent Bank of England researchers on a number of projects. And some of them actually have turned out to be really ahead of time. I think And let me also congratulate the bank for launching this One Bank research agenda, because it's extremely timely and also very important. And let me explain why by means of a story. And it's a story of a bell. This is the Metropolitana Cathedral in Mexico City. And the bell in question is it's the so-called punished one. It's the story behind this is that in 1947, a novice bell ringer died in an accident while trying to move a bell while standing underneath the bell. And then for this, the bell was punished by having its clapper removed and tied down and to remain so for 50 years. It was eventually commuted in the Jubilee of 2000, and it's allowed to ring again, but it's still called La Castigada, the punished one. There's even a YouTube video of this if you're interested. Now, why is this of interest? Well, before we become too smug about this, we have to ask ourselves, are we guilty sometimes of the same thing, which is to actually commit a category mistake where we attribute properties to things that cannot possibly have that property. And I think we are, I think, sometimes guilty of that when we talk about the market's expectation and treat it as if the market were a rational individual capable of coherent beliefs. And so here's where the emphasis on central bank communication comes in. The fact that you can sit down with the market and reason with the market and try and fine-tune policy actions in order to influence outcomes. But the market is not a person. The market is an outcome. The market prices are outcomes from the interaction of many people, not the coherent beliefs of any one person. And what this means is that we have to be very careful that we don't attribute too much coherence and think of prices as being beliefs. Now, we know from the literature that monetary policy seems to have the biggest kick from risk premium changes. The risk premium is a fancy way of saying we don't know what's going on. This is it's the unexplained residual in prices, and it's these shifts which seem to have the biggest kick. Let me illustrate with this chart from paper by my colleague Philip Turner. It's for the emerging markets. We call this the triptych chart. The left-hand panel is the average of five-year local currency government bonds from 9 emerging markets. Middle panel is the volatility of those yields, and the final panel is the exchange rate. The vertical black line is the event associated with the taper tantrum in 2013. Now, both the sustained compression of yields before the taper tantrum and the subsequent increase are not really very well explained by the fundamentals of these countries. It's much more to do with risk-taking, financial conditions, risk appetite. And risk appetite, again, is more or less synonymous with a risk premium. We just don't know how those things are defined. This is where the risk-taking channel of monetary policy, I think, becomes quite important. The idea here is that the transmission of monetary policy comes not simply through expectations, but also through risk-taking and the fluctuations of that risk-taking of financial market participants. So the term itself was coined by my colleagues Claudio Borio and Haibin Zhu, but it's been subsequently taken up by many other people. Although we call it the channel in the singular, it's actually a collection of channels rather than a single channel. It involves a variety of different financial intermediaries. I think we now know a little bit more about the leverage cycle having to do with banks and bank-like institutions. But we possibly know less about the risk-taking done by the long-term institutions. It could either manifest itself as reaching for yield, where you're going down the spectrum of risky assets, or it could be actually something quite the reverse, where you're chasing disappearing yields, or indeed negative yields, if you're an institution that has to match duration, and as interest rates fall, your liability duration is running away from you. But all of these cases are instances where it's not really the expectations of the future that matters, it's really other things that constrain, and it's going to interact. So the first thing I think we need to do to fulfill this one bank research agenda is to get to know your players. So you really need to know something much more about the micro constituents of these mechanisms. It means knowing much more about the modes of financial intermediation, knowing or getting to know better how they react to market prices and in reaction to each other. And crucially, be on the lookout for amplification mechanisms. So we know a lot about now, we now know a lot about the amplification mechanisms associated with leverage, but equally, there are equally interesting and I think pernicious amplification mechanisms, or they could be, associated with these other players too. We have to delve into those. This leads me to macroprudential policy, and Misa gave a very good description of how the various policy strands can map into the institutional framework. But I think one thing we can say is that macroprudential policy and conventional monetary policy have a lot in common as well. So if we think about a taxonomy of macroprudential tools, a very big part would be addressing the demand for credit. So these are things like loan-to-value ratios, debt service-to-income ratios, and so on. They operate on the asset side of a bank's balance sheet. And then there are those tools that operate on the financial intermediary itself, such as capital rules, counter-cyclical capital requirements, or leverage caps, and so on. And they could also be liability-sized tools. If we think about monetary policy, think about the Euler equation and the role that interest rates have in shifting consumption back and forth. And it's debt, it's credit that allows you to bring consumption forward. And so monetary policy will have an effect on the demand for credit. Clearly, the risk-taking channel will have an effect on leverage, and it also determines funding costs. So the conclusion is that it's actually very difficult sometimes to disentangle monetary policy and macroprudential policy. In fact, if you think about risk-taking as the linchpin, we can think of financial stability not as a separate area of concern, but it's really just the flip side of monetary policy transmission. I think that's, a very, very important part of the one bank research agenda. We need to ascertain what these interactions are. So I'm going to just take Andy's abbreviations here to save space. What is the interaction between monetary policy and macroprudential policy? Well, they both have impact on the demand for credit, on leverage, and funding conditions. But here's a crucial question. Should MOPO and MacroPU pull in the same direction, or should they pull in opposite directions? In other words, when you tighten, should you tighten them together, or do you have the discretion to actually allow them to pull in opposite directions? And another question we should address is the objective to lean against booms, or is it to build resilience? I think that's a crucial issue when we talk about capital requirements. And this has to do with sorting out stocks and flows, as a recent paper by my colleagues Draymond and Eusebius have also pointed out. So here's the second to-do list, which is to find out more on how financial stability considerations should enter into the conduct of monetary policy, and how, in particular, should monetary policy and macroprudential policy be used in concert. Now, there's a residual question, which Misa also mentioned, which is, how does this debate, how is this debate affected when you have open capital markets? So let me just finish with global liquidity. Now, let's see what emerging market central banks have done as a matter of practice, before we look at the normative questions. So here's a chart from our annual report from last year. The red line is the actual policy rate of a group of 18 emerging markets. The blue line is the Taylor rule rate. So this is a theoretical policy rate that would have been the case had they used a conventional Taylor rule. And we see that there are these huge gaps during the run-up to the crisis, and then in the subsequent period as well. So from judging by the way that they've actually behaved, they have tried to lean against capital inflows by keeping monetary policy looser than they would otherwise have been. And one channel that might be working is something like this, where we have the global banking sector providing credit to local corporations. Imagine this is an emerging market corporate who actually has a currency mismatch. It could be, for example, to hedge export receivables, although hedging and speculation are always difficult to tell apart, even ex post. In any case, when the dollar is depreciating and the local currency is appreciating, it means that the borrower's balance sheet is becoming stronger, it's becoming more creditworthy, which means that the lending capacity of the regional banks and the global banks are also expanding. And I think what we saw in the run-up to the crisis was that this interaction between exchange rates and lending capacity turned out to be very important. And in the model, and here I'll just do some advert for some of my own work, if you increase the local interest rate of the borrowing country, you may exacerbate this kind of spiral. And this leads, I think, to one of the questions that has become, I think, one of the most pressing questions, and it's been popularized by Hélène Rey, which is the question of whether we face a trilemma or a dilemma in international finance. And the question is, if we have free capital mobility and then floating exchange rates and autonomous monetary policy, the trilemma proposition is that you can have two of the three. And in particular, the question is, if you have floating exchange rates, is that sufficient to have autonomous monetary policy? And that's where the debate is. And Hélène is now leaning towards the view that even floating exchange rates may not be enough for the reasons that, for one of the reasons that I showed you in the previous chart. So here's the third to-do list item, which is to learn more about the channels of spillovers, and in particular, how does this interaction between monetary policy and macroprudential policy depend on the phase of global liquidity? So here's just a reiteration of that list. And it's a pretty forbidding list, but I think this is, if we can make some progress on these three questions, I think this will be a huge success for the One Bank research agenda. And just speaking for myself, this is the way that we have tried to organize our research at the BIS.
Well, thank you very much for having me here. It's a pleasure to be here again. So I thought I'd make my comments focus on a very particular question. Should the central bank have a tripartite mandate that includes financial stability? That is, on top of its concerns over inflation and real activity, should we also worry about financial stability? In some ways, the reason why I put my comments starting from that question is that I anticipated, rationally if you want, but without much difficulty, didn't take much forecasting ability, that in some ways the previous panelists would almost start from the presumption that the answer was yes. The crisis was by now, I think, inarguably a financial crisis, and as one of the major agents of macro policy, I think the central bank is either partially responsible for it, or if not, should be so in the future. If we are to work to avoid a similar recession, it must be that in some ways the central bank has to take advantage of financial recessions. Therefore, let me be clear from the start that I do think that central banks should worry very much about financial stability. But in my 9 remaining minutes, I want to take the position of a skeptic, not again because I am a skeptic, but because I think that's a good way in order to come up with a set of questions and agenda that one must then pursue in order to be able to incorporate financial stability into central banking goals. And I think the best way to approach this question is to look at the dual mandate. Because the dual mandate may now be consensual, I believe, across most central banks in the developed world, but it was still very hotly debated, certainly even just 20 years ago. Should the central bank have another goal beyond just controlling of inflation? Controlling inflation is a very easy goal. After all, we know that the central bank ultimately controls inflation, and it matters for welfare, so if something matters and you control it, you better have a goal, you better have it as your goal. Output, though, real activity, I think from a presumption that maybe you should do something about it, there was many questions raised by research as well as practitioners and central bankers, and many issues that were overcome, I think, with success over the last 30, 40, one could even say 100 years of research. The first one was a realization that the central bank cannot affect the level of output, since we all have come to believe in the proposition of longer monetary neutrality, and that when the central bank forgets this, it ends up very often with bad outcomes in the sense of higher inflation without any gains in output. A second lesson is that then if one does not worry about, even though one central bank cannot affect the level, it does affect, or it does worry about gaps, that is, to think about the deviation of unemployment from the natural rate, or to think about output gaps, or sometimes it's called the fluctuations in real activity. And the big concern in research has been, can we actually measure this? It's fine to talk about a gap, but it only becomes a useful concept if one can measure it with some reliance and being aware that one is going to have a tremendous amount of measurement error as one goes along. Third, is it feasible to affect that gap? That is there a Phillips curve? Is the big umbrella that characterizes literature? Can the central bank indeed trade off some inflation with respect to real activity? Fourth, is there a conflict? There may be a trade-off, but if it turns out that whenever you control inflation, you control real activity, you better only have just one goal because the second goal will always coincide. And the question here is the big debate on supply shocks. That is there sometimes periods when you have a trade-off where the evolution of inflation tells you to raise rates, whereas the evolution of unemployment tells you to lower rates? Fifth, even if we accept all 1, 2, 3, and 4, is policy activism a good idea, and in particular, the importance to have rules and commitments in order to constrain discretionary power? And sixth, perhaps more recently, the whole literature on communication, that is, even if one accepts 1 to 5, to what extent can the central bank communicate its dual goals and steer expectations? Well, let's apply the same criteria to financial stability as a tripartite goal. First, and I think these will, I think, raise many of the questions that the one bank agenda hopefully we'll make progress on. And to be clear, a lot of progress has already been made in all six. But I think all six are not close questions in any way, and so should be raised. First, what determines the limits, such as with a level of output? What are the limits of financial regulation? You do not have to be a deep economic historian to know that financial regulation is often synonym for financial repression, i.e. a way for the government to tax broad monetary aggregates beyond the monetary base, that is to expand its seniorage reach. How do we, as we get the central bank entrusted with financial regulation, do we prevent the government from the temptation to engage in simply extraction of taxation through financial repression? Second, when one talks then about measure financial stability, how do we go and come up with real-time measurements? I think this is, as Hyun mentioned, is probably one of the areas where we've had the most progress in the last 5 years. And now we can talk about leverage, spreads, funding needs of intermediaries as being very promising areas. We're still not quite at the point as having an unemployment gap or an output gap, or certainly having the amount of effort in building these. But there, I think we've made quite a bit of progress. Third, can now the tools of the central bank affect them systematically? Can we pin down prudential tools? Again, this was mentioned before in the first talk. We already have a sense in how loan-to-value and others will have an effect, but it is important to realize that research so far has rejected the null hypothesis of zero effect, which is different from knowing the effect is 3.5, which is what one needs in order to have reliable monetary policy actions. Fourth, is financial stability separate from inflation and output stability, or if you want a macro stability? And I think here the important question which has to be raised is, and that a central bank has to confront is, if inflation is on your target, say of 2%, if your estimates of unemployment are at the natural rate, and yet there are some measures of accumulating leverage or of widening spreads here or there, do you want to raise interest rates because of those signs of financial stability? That is the right question. It is not whether, well, unemployment is low anyway, and so we'll do something. It's, will you be willing to do so? And I have here a very brief recent experience, which is 1 year ago, inflation was below target in the US, unemployment was above what we think was the natural rate, and yet there were some estimates that financial market was overheating because of some changes in leverage and spreads in different parts of the financial market in the US. There was an active debate in the Federal Reserve about whether there should be raising rates earlier because of this. And this debate was a very difficult one to have. The conclusion was not to do so. And if you wanted to ignore the third leg of the mandate, and I think ex post that was probably the right decision because a few months later, a lot of these measures went down. But this is, I think, the kind of very tough questions that we have to ask. Fourth, where are the rules? We know very well as well, there's been a lot of research and a lot of knowledge on the moral hazards associated with bailing out. Well, financial regulation, macrofinancial regulation, are basically mini versions of these same moral hazard problems. And so in that regard, again, the old debate on rules of discretion is one that we must have, but at this level, which is smaller than the bailouts, but important. And finally, how do we communicate this effectively?
especially with financial decisions. Let's think here about the choices of making a house, of buying a house. If we're going to be changing loan-to-value ratios and others, the same arguments that say that we should perhaps be very transparent about how we're changing interest rates will say that we want to be very transparent about that, since this will certainly affect agents' decisions, and my personal decision of whether to buy a house now or in 6 months will be affected by that. How will we have a transparent communication policy when it comes, say, to loan-to-values or others, I think is a big challenge. And so all six challenges that I spoke about for our real activity and which we've worked a lot, I think we can put and I think would frame very well the challenges that the financial stability will have to face. My second set of comments are on something that was not mentioned, I think, in the research agenda, the One Bank research agenda, and where I'm going to be using my hat as an academic in this panel, be a little provocative, but I think rightly insofar as one thing that has not been mentioned that I think is actually quite important. In 2008, we absolutely learned, as I started my talk, that financial regulation, macroprudential regulation is absolutely important and that we should be doing it. I've learned, I think, since 2010, or with the crisis of 2010, with the crisis of 2011 and 12 in Europe, as well as the actions of the Fed in the US since then. Well, in the US and the UK, what I learned, I think, and I have, not just me, well, as Ben Bernanke put very eloquently, QE works in practice but not in theory. That is, we learned that QE works. That is, that somehow shortening the maturity of the debt held by the public seems to lower long-term interest rates, seems to flatten the yield curve, and seems to stimulate aggregate demand at the zero lower bound. In the euro area, we've learned that sovereign debt markets can be very volatile and very costly and lead to very deep crisis, and that a central bank that steps in, as in the famous Mario Draghi, do whatever it takes, can make a difference. And everywhere, we've learned that banks holding government bonds often lead to a diabolic loop where one and the other drag each other in parts of panic. What is common to these things is public debt. And so as someone asks about financial stability, I'm inclined to ask, what about public debt management? What about the management of the public debt? And so let me raise a few questions that are open, or a few things that I know that will indicate that or that the central bank may want to worry about this. First, the central bank has used its balance sheet to control the net supply of government securities for maturities. On the left panel there, I have the portfolio of the Fed at different dates in time, ordered by maturity. And you see not just the increase in the balance sheet, but especially the effort of the Fed to hold more and more long-term bonds. And on the right panel, you see that compared to the red line, privately held debt, and the purple line, Federal Reserve held, the US for the last few years has held essentially half of all outstanding government bonds of maturity more than 5 years. The Fed has actively manipulated, if you want, it's controlled what is the effective net supply of government securities. Second, a challenge is to what extent is this investment in long-term bonds pose a risk to the central bank, because ultimately the central bank will be borrowing short-term in reserves and investing long-term in government bonds, a short-long strategy that can lead to losses. And to what extent can the central bank become insolvent in the sense of having losses above balance sheet capital? And I put there some simulations that under some fairly extreme scenarios for inflation, the central bank of the US could easily lose all its balance sheet capital, which is not to mean that it's insolvent, just that the losses could be significant. Third, how does it coordinate with the Treasury? In this picture, I show you the well-known fact that as the Fed was doing QE and as a result reducing the duration of the US debt, the Treasury in the US was issuing more and more long-term debts and as a result extending the maturity, partly offsetting it. Whereas in the UK, we have the famous letter by Mervyn King asking the Treasury, as the Bank of England went into QE actions, to not undo its effect. Fourth, when we come to the public debt, to what extent does the actions of the Fed affect the supply of reserve or safe assets? One big part of the crisis seems to have been, or according to, so it's a popular opinion that part of the crisis was driven by the lack of safe assets in the economy. The Federal Reserve or the central bank certainly has an effect on this, both by issuing reserves as well as by buying or retiring or buying long-term debt. To what extent can the central bank control the supply of safe assets and therefore perhaps offset any demand for those safe, any shortfalls in demand or supply for those? And finally, getting to bank regulation and the holding of banks and bonds, the well-known plots, and I put here one on the left for Portuguese banks, and on the right for Ireland, and these are the CDS prices on the main banks in Portugal as well as on the sovereign, and the right on Ireland before and after the bailout of the Irish banks. And we see this remarkable correlation in Portugal always and in Ireland after the bailout, where essentially the problems of the bank and the problems of the sovereign are one and the same. So, well, well, because the banks are exposed to sovereign risk. So I come up with these five arguments or reasons why, in the same way that one comes up with arguments for why the central bank should be engaging in macroprudential regulation, for why the central bank should be engaging in public debt management, manage the maturity of debt, manage the supply of government bonds that are there outstanding. I said I was going to be provocative, and I am, because of course there was a big danger in doing this, and that is that when we've had central banks managing the public debt, and many central banks in the world still do it to some extent, but when they were in charge of managing the public debt as being one of their main tasks, that was the case of many developed country central banks just 50 years ago, we learned very quickly that there was a very fine line between managing the public debt and financing the public debt, and we learned all about the problems of inflation bias and the problems of inflating away your debt and of financing the public debt that way. So, in my 10 minutes, I try to make two points. First, that I think there's an exciting agenda on financial stability. I applaud the bank for engaging in it. I think we will learn very much, and we've already learned very much in the last 3 or 4 years, work at the BIS in particular and other places, and there's much to work on. My suggestion is draw on why we think that central banks care about real activity, because that provides a very clear set of research targets that will complement the way in which they were set out, I think, so far and in the bank management. And second, in terms of the missing agenda, there's absolutely a taboo that comes from the separation between fiscal and monetary policy to talk about the central bank as managing the public debt in the terms that I spoke about them. And I think that may be a very important taboo. But at the same time, as we expand our efforts into fighting the war of 2008 and 10 on macroprudential regulation and understanding how to deal with banks, there's also been another war, which is the public debt war, that is, to what extent holdings of banks of public debt, changes in sovereign debt markets, have also posed very important challenges for central banks and have had central banks affect them directly through their actions. And of course, the common problem that both of these, both the macroprudential as well as the public debt management, are yesterday's war, and who knows what will be tomorrow's one. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ricardo, and to the other panelists. We have about 20 minutes for questions. What I propose is that we group two or three and then ask people on the panel to pick them up. If I might just exercise chairman's exorbitant privilege and start with a question, which is, what can the research agenda tell us about where the boundaries of macroprudential should lie, and to what extent the macroprudential authority should be concentrated on the resilience and the risk in the financial system, but to what extent should you care about the wider economy, even if the financial system is resilient in the build-up of financial stability risks? So if I can put that on the table for some of the panelists, and then if we take a question from over here, please. Perhaps if you say who you are at the beginning, it would help.
I'm Rosa Lastra of Queen Mary University of London. And my question relates to the complementarity or separation between the different functions, as well as the relationship between objectives and functions. If we look back, as the panel has done, to the history over the last 20 years, we have moved from what I would call the Bundesbank model, in which you have one authority, the central bank, one goal, price stability, and one main instrument, monetary policy, to a very different model, which, for the purposes of simplicity, let us call the Fed model, in which we have several objectives, in which we have several functions, and in which we have several interactions. And it's much more complex, the second model, because for each of the objectives, like for financial stability, is not just the central bank objective. Financial stability is also an objective for Treasury, is also an objective for all the supervisory entities, and in the context of Dodd-Frank, is the overarching objective these days. And when we look at the different instruments, you know, should the goal, as you said, of monetary policy be price stability, or should it also be financial stability as the overarching objective? And my question or comment relates to the differences that we see in different countries. I mean, part of the one bank agenda is not to think that, you know, no country, or I should say no economy is an island, because in the UK is still an island. And I'm seeing different directions in how this debate is progressing. I mean, it's clearly that in the US, the overarching goal of financial stability is motivating the working of the different agencies as well as the Financial Stability Oversight Council. In the In Europe, in the ECB, they're not emphasizing the separation between monetary policy and the newly functions, the new functions of prudential supervision. I think that's wrong. And I think, you know, that the one bank agenda, by emphasizing the complementarity of the different functions, is in the right direction. But my question is that when we're listening today, there were some missing points that were discussed. But the one function that seems to link everything, and I would say macroprudential policy, monetary policy, and I don't like microprudential policy. I think microprudential supervision, because it's not so much a policy as actually supervision of specific entities, is the function of lender of last resort or emergency liquidity assistance. And again, you know, you mentioned that it was 20 years ago that, you know, we have had this price stability. But if you look back at the origins of central banking, I mean, the twin mandate of safe money, of stable money and safe banking has always been there. Vera Luth-Smith, in her famous rationale of central banking, already talked about that. And to some extent, we have forgotten and we're trying to go back. And obviously, financial stability is much more these days than safe banking. But I would like, you know, the panel perhaps to reflect about this complementarity versus separation.
Thank you. Richard, you had a...
I won't try to get up out of this very deep seat.
I think you've described macroprudential.
Rosemary is just more agile, that's all. I have just what seems to me a lacuna in the paper and the agenda, and that is derivative markets. The only mention I heard in this panel was Ricardo's chart of CDS prices. And it seems to me that the issues are very wide. And let me just flag three. One is the size and opacity of these markets. The regulators have been trying to introduce more transparency. How can we expect that transparency to affect the functioning of those markets and their interrelation with other markets? The second, the extent to which these markets can act as amplification mechanisms. That was mentioned. The importance of possible amplification mechanisms was mentioned as the subject for research, but my own work and that of some others suggests that this is a major potential channel for the way in which derivatives markets can affect the rest of the economy. And finally, central counterparties and the dangers of central counterparties and the risks inherent in central counterparties. Does more collateralization actually make us safe? What are the risks in what effectively going towards very monopolistic or oligopolistic structure of those central counterparties, which means that each of them will have huge, huge balance sheets at any given point in time? So those are things that I'd like the panel to, maybe these shouldn't be as important as other things in the agenda. The research here can't cover everything, but that's my take.
Okay, look, what I'm going to do is I'm going to reverse the order and start with Ricardo and then Shin and then Misa on the three questions. Boundaries of macro pru, the multiplication and potential confusion of central bank objectives, and this question of derivative markets. And what role should they play in the agenda?
Absolutely. I'll answer them, though, in a different order. That's okay. So I'm going to start with the complementarity between functions. I mean, you mentioned very well that, of course, central banks have always had safe banking or stability of banking as one of their goals. But, of course, that leaves open a tremendous amount of room for interpretation from a view which I think was dominant, which was that that had to do with lender of last resort. Absolutely no one has ever argued that central banks should not be a lender of last resort. The question is whether, on top of that, it needs to have a very aggressive macroprudential or microprudential policy or not. And I think that's the question that we're asking today. But no one in their right mind would, I think, say that the central bank should excuse itself from its lender last resort rules. On the complementarities, I think the complementarity, and this ties in a little bit with my remarks, a lot of it comes basically from the people working upstairs from us, which is the staff. I mean, what the central bank has, which the Treasury does not have in managing its debt, which a lot of the financial stability does not have, is a staff that's highly qualified and specialized in taking into account both its low-frequency goals as well as doing high-frequency monitoring of the activity and in internalizing the externalities, if you want, between these different objectives, between these different needs. That is what makes the central bank, it's, I think, an understanding that those externalities are stronger, an understanding that the staff and others will have difficulty keeping up, given that they do not have the resources, the expertise, the specialization in pure economics, even, that the central bank staff has, that I think have led to the central bank being the natural holder of these macroprudential objectives and targets and others. On Richard and on the derivatives, I agree wholeheartedly. I think derivatives are extremely important. You mentioned them in terms of the challenges that they pose. One could also raise their opportunities. I mean, derivatives give us a tremendous amount of information when it comes to some of these things on monitoring financial stability, and I think understanding that market, and I think on there I have all of the three of the to-do list from Hyun, which is they apply completely well to derivatives, not just as a source of potential danger, but especially as a source of information. We have a tremendous amount of information on what's going on in the markets from them. And when I say information, I do not mean to say that it is good information or rational information from markets, but just valuable information of where the markets are going, which I think is useful. And let me skip on the binds of macroprudential policy just on this.
Yeah. Okay, why don't I pick up on that point then,
okay.
Which is, I think, possibly the most important policy question that faces us today. To some extent, what we call macroprudential policies are actually not that new. If you think back to the period before financial liberalization, to the 1970s, for example, many of the policies that Charles has written a lot about look very much like macroprudential policies. They were actually credit policies, policies that actually try to intervene directly on the quantities. The specific question of where the boundaries are, I think, is perhaps not the best question to ask. I think the perhaps the better question is what is the right perspective that we approach this question, rather than where should the boundary be? I think I think one of the dangers we might fall into is where we think of the boxes as corresponding to specific and limited economic effects that we can actually somehow cordon off and examine separately from the rest. And if that is somehow also ossified into institutional settings, and we then settle into a framework where one part of the institution looks at a particular set of policies, another part of the policy of the institution looks at another set, then we may get into a situation where we actually miss something, something in the middle. I think One area where I think this tension comes most closely, I think, is the fact that many of the policies that we have in mind are bank-related policies, and in particular, the regulated bank-related policies. It's not so clear now that the dangers that, or the possible dangers that we have now, are those that can satisfactorily be addressed with policies that are aimed at the regulated banks. And I think this is where I think the perspective is much more important than the specific tools. So,
pick a question or all questions.
Sure. So I think quickly on the derivatives issues, I think some of these issues will be covered by Sujit later on. But also, I think on the separation of macroprudential policy and monetary policy issue, I think that is clearly an important issue. But I think where, to the extent that macroprudential policy has a cyclical element, I think it is important that it is coordinated with monetary policy. But so whoever does it, there's some requirement for coordination with monetary policy authority. But I think there are fundamental challenges associated with having a clear macroprudential policy framework, regardless of who does it. And I think that's where further research is needed.
All right. I'm going to move on over to this side of the room. Can I ask the questioners to keep the questioners quite brief, please?
Alistair Mill, London University. Quick question about
the microphone.
Okay. Alistair Mill, Loughborough University. A short question about the targets of macro pru. I still think there's a lot to be debated about exactly what we should be monitoring. And I guess this is more for Hyun Song, perhaps, than others. But could these measures of risk appetite and so forth actually themselves be useful as targets of macroprudential policy as opposed as a way of distinguishing from the monetary?
Okay. Did you, if you just pass it to you. to your right, that's efficient.
John Milbauer from Oxford. A non-bank regulation can have quite an important impact on the way in which QE works, and to take up Ricardo's point about debt management particularly. Depending upon how insurance companies are regulated and pension funds are regulated, QE, which reduces yields to very low levels, inflates the measured deficits of these funds, and then that can have big negative consequences on contribution rates and on investment by companies. So how countries differ, the US versus the UK, for example, can have quite an important impact on how successful QE is in impacting on the real economy. So non-bank regulation is a really important issue, and the Bank of England's pro-cyclical working party, which produced a report earlier this year, addressed these issues.
Thank you, and just at the top, please.
Yeah, Philip Davis, NISA and Brunel University. I spent a lot of time at the bank from 1980 to 2000, and there was an objective which was sort of in the background that was still felt to be quite important at the time. So I'm just asking what people's views of it is. And that objective was preservation of London as a global financial center. Obviously a key issue in the light of possible Brexit as well in the future. So just a question from a researcher point of view, is that something the bank is still interested in?
Okay, I mean, I'm going to start the answers, I think. It might be easier for the bank to answer your last question. I'm sure there are views there. Maybe if we started at this end, I mean, it's on the targets for macro prue, the role of particularly the non-bank regulated sector in QE, and then this last question, I think, we might pick up here.
On targets, I'm not sure if I'm the person best placed to answer this question, but I think it's good to have a target, quantified target, for the sake of accountability, which and also to ensure that expectation of the financial market participants are anchored. I'm not sure if it will be possible in the near term to develop a quantified target. I think the best we can do might be to use a combination of multiple indicators to gauge the state of systemic risk and respond to that and communicate our policies as best as possible. Now, the problem with indicators is the good hat off, that if we start reacting to indicators, the relationship between indicators and the underlying systemic risk might break down. I think that is a fundamental challenge for macroprudential policy. I don't have an answer to how to solve the problem, and I do look forward to hear from the research committee about where this should lead to.
Yes, so Alistair asked a very interesting question, which is whether you can actually treat these measures of risk appetite as the target of policy. I think that's an intriguing idea, but probably it's going to be very difficult to put into practice, because the outcome is the outcome of the interaction of many, many different actors, and it's one thing to tell one person or use moral suasion to persuade someone, but it's quite another thing to try and predict what the outcome will be. Because there are also these interaction effects, you quite often see these binary outcomes where if everyone else is taking risk, then you want to take risk as well. So we have these flipping results. Possibly the better indicators will be things to do with quantities. And at the BIS, and also before I joined the BIS in my own research, seems that it's these quantity indicators that seem to give the right kind of information at fairly low frequency and therefore at a very timely level as well. And John's question about duration, I think, is really one of the most important questions right now. There was a line in my presentation about institutions chasing low yields and indeed chasing negative yields. I think there's we have to be very, very cognizant of possible amplifications that have to do with long-term investors that are driven by duration. And because structurally liability duration tends to be slightly longer, and because we have this convexity of duration, when interest rates fall, your liabilities are running away from you, and so you're forced to chase duration. I think this is possibly why we're seeing a very sharp fall in the ultra-long government bond yields. So if you look at the prices now, we see a lot of the action at the 30-year and longer, as well as the 10-year. And it may not be completely, I think, you know, that may be objective to some in some respects, but there are, you know, but there will be side effects too. And in particular, there will be side effects about how you read this kind of signal. If this feeds into your measures of inflation risk, like the inflation swap contracts and so on, then you may be actually looking at yourself in the mirror and chasing your mirror further forward. So I think this is something we need to, I think, do much more research on. And I think this is why the conventional set of macroprudential policies are not where we should be looking right now, I think. I think we have to look much broader than that.
Let me briefly both respond to Yun and John and actually answer your first question on the boundaries of macroprudential policy, which is to say that, in many ways, that was the spirit of the first half of my talk, which is to say that this boundaries question is not as novel as it seems. We were having a boundaries question 20, 30, 40 years ago. The boundary then was just, should we worry about real activity or focus wholeheartedly on inflation? And I think it's precisely, once you see it from that perspective, then I hope to have transmitted that I don't think studying macroprudential or financial stability should be a scary thing. It should certainly not be something that we should shy away from, because over the last 50 years, as we've changed our mind about how much the central bank can do about real activity, we never once in any central bank that I know of stopped putting a humongous amount of resources into studying the trade-offs between real activity and inflation. And that was the case. What worries me a little bit, and thus my, if you wanted, constructive skepticism, is that in the case of financial policy, or financial stability, we've embraced very quickly the policy aims, whereas the research is still trying to catch up, unlike when it came to the real stability, I think. And that is something that precisely I applaud, again, the one bank research agenda, because the research has to catch up, because it's one case where I think policy is ahead of research. And on related and on what John said, as well as Yun, yes, on the second part of my talk was trying to emphasize that as we're discussing difficult new instruments, many of whom are not new, as Yun emphasized, there is one thing that central banks have been doing for a long time, which is intervening in public debt markets. That's the bread and butter of what central banks do. And QE is certainly less of a radical step than many of the macroprudential policy we've discussed. And that in itself is something that, as I try to raise with 6 or 7 points, something that we don't understand well, I completely agree with everything that John said. And I think it's one more point, one more slide that I could have added to the open challenges and to the issues that Yun said. And I would like us to spend also more time on understanding precisely how, when the central bank interacts in public debt markets, how it regulates holders of public debt, not just banks, like Yun said, insurance companies, other holders of debt. Well, that's something where a central bank has a very direct tool. It issues reserves, it buys the different maturities. It's going to have, I think, a very profound effect. It has a very profound effect. It raises a series of interesting questions, and I would like us to pursue them as well.
So let me try to respond to the questions on point. You know, does the bank have an implicit objective to promote London as a financial sector? And the answer is no. We're not the champion of the city of London. Our role is to enhance, maintain micro and macro prudential resilience. Now, when you think about the competitiveness of the financial system in the UK, it's built on, you know, arguably three things. Those factors, the resilience of the system, high standards of conduct, and then with that, and that being an objective, to be clear, and then with those, given those priors, innovation and service and beyond, which is the responsibility of the industry. So we stay focused on our core responsibilities there, and we're not going to shade those in order to provide some competitive advantage, because in the end, the fundamentals have to be there. And you know, it's clearly one of the lessons of the crisis was some blurring of that, particularly on the regulatory side, where there was an element of the old FSA that had elements of competitiveness in the mandate. Where resilience and conduct come together, issues at present are around particularly fixed income currency commodity markets, and that's what, in part, the Fair and Effective Markets Review is trying to address. And then let me just finish by saying a word on regulation, the regulatory boundary. We have obviously started at the core, the collective we have started at the core of the banking system to make the banking system more resilient, not just because there was an emperor has no clothes element to the banking system in the on the eve of the crisis or exposed with the crisis, but also because the system absolutely amplified the risks and the shocks from the shadow banking system. There were multiple linkages through contingent liquidity lines, holding of asset-backed securities, derivative counterparties, et cetera, monoline insurers, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so we've been reducing or eliminating those linkages, dampening those amplification mechanisms. And it's very early days, and this is a question for research, but one of the lessons of the taper tantrum of October 15th and the Swiss National Bank of others is that actually, thus far, the core has not amplified those shocks. You know, we'll see how long that endures, but that's part of the strategy. It means, though, that there are risks that we now need to address in the broader area of market-based finance, and that includes, and Hyun Shin has led intellectually on this, it's not just about the tradition, you know, the leverage channels that we've been tackling through repo and securities lending markets, but actually unlevered maturity mismatch in the asset management complex, and those activities very much a focus of all of us. And then I'll just finish on the questions on Richard had around derivatives and CCPs. You know, we're pretty comfortable that there has been net risk reduction in moving a complex web of bilateral relationships, derivative relationships, into CCPs. But at the same time, those CCPs, those nodes, as you're intimating, are systemic, or can be systemic if of any size. And that puts a premium on ensuring that they are resilient, that they can be resolved. And that is absolutely a priority of the authorities. What we haven't exploited yet is the information we've now collected through trade repositories. So even the most complex derivative, that which is not cleared through a CCP, is reported into a trade repository. That's useful if we can have a global picture of that. And this is a priority, for what it's worth, at the G20 this year, to remove some of the legal and other impediments to global sharing of that information. So it's your question's very on point. I think at this stage it's probably more a practical question of policy, of reform implementation, before we end up having the richer set of information that then research can tackle in order to bring broader insights.
Leave it there. Thank you. Look, in the fitting tradition of the bank, I'm going to let the governor have the last word, which he's just had. Right. And bring this panel to a conclusion. I know there are many more questions, but I hope this won't be the last chance, maybe just the first chance, to discuss these issues with some of you. But can we all thank our panelists as well for their...